I'm Chuck Wolf, Chief Executive for Charles J. Wolf Associates, a results-oriented consulting firm dedicated to improving leadership, motivation, and performance. I really value making a meaningful difference in people's lives. My expertise includes motivational speaking, executive coaching, leadership consulting and development, talent management, culture change, and team building. Perhaps I can help you. I have worked with some of the best companies in the world, such as Exxon, Coca-Cola, Disney, ESPN, Foxwoods, United Technologies, Marriott, and many of the major insurance and financial service companies. I have consulted with and worked at some of the world's great institutions of learning, such as Harvard, MIT, Wharton, and Yale. I began working, though, as a salesperson. In a turning point in my life, I realized that my sales skills could be used to sell almost anything. Growing up in the 60s, I had a turning point where I decided I would devote myself to selling people on themselves. I got involved in mental health, worked for a state institution for the mentally insane. There I got wonderful training in family systems, group dynamics, and community therapy. While the work was rewarding, I decided to turn away from institutionalized patients and determined to work with young children to help them to learn how to stay mentally healthy. I became the state of Iowa's first elementary school counselor, had some wonderful experiences in the role. I wanted to share what I was learning and make it happen on a larger scale, and I got accepted to a doctoral program at Harvard. While there, I worked in Harvard Business School's Executive Program for Management Development and learned all about organizational behavior. The connections I was making among various workplaces, selling door to door, working in an institution for people who are mentally challenged, helping young children and their families learn about dealing constructively with emotions such as anger and sadness, and then working with executives who are charged with creating and managing large-scale organization changes that generate emotional resistance almost all the time. All the pieces were like a puzzle that was coming together for me. In 1999, I was invited to work with Yale President Peter Salovey and Professor Jack Mayer by David Caruso. Peter and Jack were the two pioneering psychologists who are known for their groundbreaking research on emotional intelligence. My work with them resulted in my creating the Emotion Roadmap, a process that helps anyone to improve how they manage emotions in challenging situations. Now my talks, my motivational speaking, my consulting and training, my writing and publications, all are aimed at helping people understand how to use the Emotion Roadmap to make life better for themselves, for those they lead, those they love, and for those they don't love and don't like but do need to work with. In 2009, based on an invitation from a friend, Lou Pomalis, I began hosting a radio talk show called The Emotion Roadmap, Take the Wheel and Control How You Feel. On my show, I help people who call me. If you'd like to listen to the show live, and perhaps even call in, the show is broadcast on listener-supported community radio station WPKN. Or you can watch the show on community TV or on the internet. For more information, you can go to my Emotion Roadmap Facebook page, my LinkedIn profile, and my website, cjwolfwithane.com. Enjoy. And this is Chuck Wolf. You're listening to the Emotion Roadmap. Take the wheel and control how you feel. It's good to be back with you all. It's been a few weeks, and I'm hoping that all of you out there are practicing using the Emotion Roadmap. All of you that are regular listeners, thanks so much for tuning in. And anybody that might be new and just tuning in for the first time to my show, the show is all about helping you deal with emotionally challenging situations in your life. Now, what's that about? Well, that could be anything at work, from dealing with people who are in conflict, people who have overlapping decision-making, people who are struggling with the people that they work for, people who are struggling with people who work for them. It could be something to do with children, with families. It could have a lot to do with a lot of different things. I have a number of things I'd like to talk to you about today, but I also want to open up the lines for anybody that'd like to call, and I'm all set to take your phone calls. So if you've been waiting for me to get back and you have a feeling that you'd like to talk to me about something that's going on in your life, then give me a call, and the number is 203-336-9756. 203-336-9756. And as I've mentioned a few times before, the show is being videotaped, and it appears on YouTube, on Simsbury Community TV, sctv.org. And you type in Chuck Wolf. If you miss some of my shows and you want to catch them, you can find me on YouTube on Simsbury Community Television's channel. The shows on the when you watch me on YouTube aren't live, but you still get the benefit of whatever it is you think might be valuable in listening to us. So I encourage you, by the way, to listen to other shows. If you're just tuning in for my show, WPKN is a wonderful station. You've just been listening to I Messiah, and you have either Peter or you have Richard or Nick coming in later. And you know, we just have different people that come in and play music that's extremely entertaining. And we do so many different things here. I wish I could take advantage of more of them myself. If you live in the Bridgeport area, I think you're quite lucky to have WPKN around. And if you are able and you want to make a contribution, you can volunteer your time, become part of our community that way. You can volunteer whatever financial, if you have a financial donation you can make, that's great too. You can do that on our website anytime, wpkn.org. And 12 to 1 p.m. on weekdays, we have our community strip. And my show, again, is the Emotion Roadmap. Take the wheel and control how you feel. Now, what I do sometimes in my professional life is I teach people about the Emotion Roadmap, and I really concentrate that time. And I'm hoping that some of them that may have attended something that I did in the past couple of weeks where they learned all about the Emotion Roadmap will call in with some examples of how they're using it. The Emotion Roadmap, quite simply, again, if you're new to the show, is it actually combines a lot of different kind of theoretical structures. It includes change theory, appreciative inquiry, problem-solving methodologies, and the science of emotional intelligence. And that sounds like a lot, and it is. But what it does is quite simply helps you to look at the emotions that are in play anytime that you're struggling. It's been my experience that smart people struggle when something emotional is in play. If you are thoughtful right now about past situations where you're uncertain, very concerned, somewhat confused about situations in your past, or currently right now, you might have situations where you feel you're really unclear about what to do next. You're worried about escalation. You're worried about confronting somebody, and yet you feel the need to deal with an issue, and yet you don't know how. Well, when that's happening, my experience, again, of smart people, really everybody, and of course, I think everybody who listens to this show is a smart person. but when smart people struggle, it's almost always because something emotional is happening, either inside them or with people that they're dealing with. And so the Emotion Roadmap looks at, what are you feeling? What is it that anyone that's key to what you're dealing with is feeling? And as you explore that and try to understand what it is that is what your feelings are right now and what someone else who you're dealing with that's key to what's happening is feeling, you then think about what I consider to be the next step in the roadmap, which is if what you're feeling and what other people who are important to the situation are feeling is not helpful, not what you want, not ideal, what would be ideal? So if you're in Bridgeport and you need to be in Boston, how do you get there? If you're feeling anxious and you need to be confident, how do you get there? That's the idea of a roadmap. How do you get from one feeling to another that's more ideal? So if you're struggling with something and something's going on, the best way to explain how this all works is to have a real life example. And when I'm fortunate enough to have people picking up the phone and giving me a call, then I know that not only am I hopefully helping you as an individual, but everybody else out there is getting some help as well. So let me give you the number again. I'll give you a second to get a pencil out or a pen or your cell phone or whatever it is you want to type this number into. I'll write this number down. 203-336-9756. Now, I always come prepared with a few topics to talk about, but it's always more fun when people call in. 203-336-9756. I'll give you a second to make that phone call. It's great to get the show off to a quick start with a phone call right away. It's kind of like breaking the ice. You know how there's a group sometimes and people are kind of all waiting for that other person to make that first gesture,
have that first spoken word, make that first phone call, and here we go. Hi, this is Chuck Wolf. You're on the air. Who am I talking to?
Danielle.
Hi, Danielle. Could you turn your radio down?
Oh, hi.
How you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Thanks so much for calling. What's on your mind today?
Oh, just, you know, relationships. And I guess I'm a little upset because I've put a lot out there and I don't get much of a response from who I'm looking to get a response from. Like, it's not, it's like ignored and there's no initiative taken. So I've been a little frustrated because I think everyone deserves to get some feedback, even if, you know, yeah, everyone deserves to get feedback, but some people are afraid to face themselves.
I have an old standard kind of funny line about feedback, Danielle. It's everybody wants it until they get it, you know.
Yeah, I understand that. Sometimes, I don't know, like, I'm not looking for rejection, so I'll come at a different angle with just some joy. Like, how are you doing? Hey, but it doesn't really get further than that at this point.
Sometimes people want permission to give feedback. And one of the things that I think is useful if you're looking for feedback but you don't want to be overwhelmed by it is to tell somebody that that's what you're doing. You know, you'd really like to get some help or some information or get some, you know, get someone to tell you about something that you'd like to hear their feedback about. But you almost want to say, but I'd like you to be gentle about it, you know. I'd like you, if you could, if there's anything at all that I'm doing right, tell me that first. And then if there's one or two things that you think I could do better, just please stop with that. Think about the most important one or two things and let me know. Because if, I think if we hear a lot of negative stuff, we just crawl into a hole and hide. It feels like incoming missiles and you crawl into a foxhole to protect yourself. It's pretty normal. But if you position it so that people realize that, you know, you're sensitive and while it might be a bit painful, you want to grow and you want to learn and you want to be better somehow, then I think asking for it, but kind of laying out the criteria for how you'd like to get it, is probably a pretty good idea.
The thing is, I feel like me getting together with somebody that, you know, the people that I want to get together with, it's like, I feel like my history sort of repeated itself in two different situations, and if I were to get together with either of them, like, feelings might come back, and maybe that's why they're trying to, like, ignore me. But I don't want to meet with two. So actually, I don't know. I feel like both of them were my good friends, but it's, like, a similar situation, and it's really out of my control at this point. But I just feel like it wasn't really fair for me.
Did something happen that set this off, Danielle, for you that makes you feel like they're, you know, there's something that's making them uncomfortable being with you?
Maybe I gave too much away too soon.
Maybe you did what? I'm sorry.
Gave a little too much away too soon, but then again, I don't have any regrets with that because everyone wants to be understood, and some people just have a harder time communicating exactly how they feel, so you can't really get them to talk about something that they haven't processed.
Have you thought about ways that you might approach this individually as opposed to together with them separately? Have you given any thought to what you might do to try and make this right?
To be honest, I just feel like I should be the one approached instead of me having to go after anybody because I've sort of tried that already.
So you're waiting for them to come to you?
I guess so.
And are you willing to not have a relationship with them if they don't come to you?
I want to be friends with both of them. But I want to, for both of them have girlfriends now.
Right, so they don't necessarily need to be friends with you.
Right, and I feel like that's not right because I'm a Christian and I feel like we're all one, we're all part of the same body. Like, we're all connected with each other and I suffer in my heart and in my spirit. I feel like I'm in pain and I don't, you know, it's okay because God is holding me and I'm not alone, but it's actually really sad. I feel like people should care more. Because even though, for me, I have a lot of friends that reach out and, like, want to get together, guys. And I, like, don't deny anybody. I try to, you know, I try to be emotionally available for people.
Nice.
I feel that I deserve the same.
Right. You know, sometimes, I'm sure you've heard, life isn't always fair, right?
Yeah.
And here's something that you might want to think about that might be helpful to you. So you feel like you've reached out, you've opened yourself up, you may have said too much or done too much, and kind of people got uncomfortable in your presence, and yet they should become comfortable with it after they process it, and they should come back to you, and that's what you're feeling, right?
Yeah.
And so what happens is, and by the way, it's nice to be spiritual too and to believe in a deity and a Lord and feel as though you're always with someone, and that's helpful as well. But if you want to change this relationship, what I always think about is, if I'm waiting for somebody else to do something different, I have very little power over whether that happens or not. If I want to be certain that a relationship lasts and is meaningful, even when it's been, you know, tarnished or broken, even if I want to get that relationship back, I try to think about what I can do, not about fairness now, because I understand your point. But if I think about what I can do to make this better, then I'm very empowered. Then it's about me, and then there's things I can do, as opposed to just waiting and hoping. And so I would encourage you to think a bit about how they might be feeling, how you're feeling, and how you would want them and you to feel. So right now they're feeling, what would you say? How would you say they're feeling about you?
Indifferent.
And you're feeling disappointed, rejected maybe?
Yeah.
So how would you like them to feel about you now? What would you like?
Yeah. I want to be friends with them, so I perhaps should ask or go about it like, what can I do? What can I do differently in order to maintain a friendship with you?
And you think that they might be uncomfortable answering that question?
They might be nervous.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's a funny way of doing it. You say there's two of them, and they're good friends with each other?
No, they don't know each other, really.
Well, these are two completely separate people. Okay.
Yeah.
And the same thing happened with both of them. Interesting.
Yeah. And it's just, I just found myself crying over both, like, a week ago, because I felt like my best friends were ripped from me.
Okay, so then, and they both, something, so was there something similar that you did with both of them that caused this to happen, do you think?
I fell for them.
Well, I mean, about what the particular thing that you talked about or said to them? Was it sort of similar that you may have caused them to kind of move?
I sort of distanced myself from both of them, and then it's just like history sort of kind of repeated in the sense where they got girlfriends.
I don't want to make them the same, but yeah. I think if you approach, you know, one of them obviously at a time, and you ask them the question about it seems like our relationship isn't quite the same, and I'm assuming that maybe I did something that I'm not quite aware of what that was. And I'd really like to know what it was that maybe you might have found somehow offensive or upsetting or something, because you're very important to me, and I really care about you, and I would really hope that you would care about me. And if I did something that I need to do different or clean up or fix, please let me know so I can do that.
So that I can what?
Please let, if there's something that I need to do different, if there's something I need to fix, if there's something that I broke and I need a repair, please let me know what that is, because I care about you, and I would really like it if you cared about me, and I feel like I must have done something. And if you could tell me what that was, I'm really anxious and interested in doing it. I mean, that's you doing something, and maybe you don't want to reach out, but if you want this to work, you having a strategy and you having a plan about what you can do to make this right, I think is the best way to see if you can clean this up.
Thank you.
Does that help?
It really does.
Okay, so I would do it with the first one, see how well that works, and then step back and say, did I learn anything from that? Did I want to do a little different with the second one? You know, because sometimes it's great to have a plan, but the plan doesn't always work the way we want. And then Danielle, one other thing that's really important around this is when you hear what they have to say, you might want to be very defensive. I mean, it might be a normal reaction because you've asked them to tell you what you did that they didn't like and that you're going to feel criticized.
Right.
And you have to let go of that feeling of feeling criticized and just be extremely thankful and appreciative that they were willing to tell you what's in the way of you and them being good friends again. I mean, if you want to kind of set your mind to know that you're going to hear something you're not going to like, but you want to prize it and value it because they're taking some courage to tell you what's really going on for them.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, they say if you ever want anything done the right way, you got.
Well, if you look at when something's not working the way you want, and you're waiting for somebody else to do something to fix it. You know, you might be waiting forever, but if it's important enough to you, even when you feel like it's really up to them and they should do something, but if they matter to you, then and you want it to change, then I always think it's so much more empowering to think, what do I need to do different? Because I'm capable of doing things different, and I don't have to wait that way, and I can try and make it right. Okay.
Amen. Thank you.
Okay, Danielle. Great talking to you. Thanks for calling.
Anytime. God bless. Have a great day.
You too. Bye bye. Okay, that's our first caller. So we got out of the gate pretty fast today. So anybody else, you got something going on. And I hope everybody's thinking about that, about this idea of feedback. Feedback is scary. Everybody, as I said, everybody likes feedback until they get it. feedback is often very scary for people. Perhaps you know why. I got another phone call. Just a second.
Feedback is often very scary for people.
Hello, this is...
Hello.
That was interesting. Hi, this is Chuck Wolf. You're on the air.
Very scary.
Oh, can you turn your radio down? That's what I was hearing, I guess. Hello?
Hi, Chuck.
Hi, who am I talking to?
This is Sarah.
Sarah, okay, you're on the air, Sarah. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you, Chuck?
I'm great, and it's nice to talk to you. So you got a story for me about how you're using the motion roadmap?
I sure hope so. I enjoyed your class on emotional intelligence last week and thought it would be a good opportunity to call and share about how I'm using the roadmap already.
That's great, Sarah. Sure, go ahead, shoot.
Well, so far I've been in touch with a number of colleagues who are friends and consultants, and because my learning from the workshop was so fresh and so rich for me, I've been sharing the roadmap with them. And when they've been talking with me about challenges that they're having, I've been sharing this roadmap as a simple way that they can use either with themselves or their clients to work through the steps to get to a better outcome of their feelings and the feelings of others. So it's been quite a lot of fun to share this, and a number of people are very interested in this model because it's so simple to use. Personally, I've been using it, and it's becoming more common practice over the past few days, Chuck, that, you know, when things come up, good or bad, or that concern me, I go to this, and it's sort of getting ingrained in my mind now, where first I have to pause and just figure out, you know, who's involved and what am I feeling, but then also take a look at what they might be feeling. I think often we leave that second step out because we're very focused on the self.
You're so right about that. Yeah, often people feel like they got it when they figured out how to make themselves feel better. Right?
But, yep. Often there's right. Two sides to that.
Almost always. Sometimes more than two sides, right?
Yeah, exactly. So right. Once that happens, you know, whether I'm just trying to reflect on my own or I'm in discussions with somebody else, just asking, you know, what would be the ideal feeling? How do I want to feel? But also asking, how do they want to feel? And many times I've found, at least over the past few days, Chuck, there have been similar outcomes that we're looking for.
That's great, Sarah. Is there anything that's not too personal that you can share as a concrete example of how this is playing out. And thank you so much for sharing the model with everybody. And I hope to encourage them maybe to listen to the radio show, because, you know, I don't know if you had a chance to listen, but we just talked with a woman named Danielle, and the idea is to try and make this available for everybody for free, if people are willing to, you know, are able to pick up either a computer or a smartphone. We have apps for WFKN. Anybody can listen it from anywhere, which is beautiful because of technology today. But if you have something concrete that you can share, that'd be great.
Excellent. Well, I used it over the weekend. I was meeting up with someone, and we've only met up a few times, and so I was a little bit nervous. I assume they were a little bit nervous, too. So I thought of that before we left, before I met with them, thinking about how they might be feeling and how I was feeling.
Right.
And then based on our interaction, really talking about, you know, some feelings and what would be ideal. And that was really helpful. We both admitted we were kind of nervous but excited. I was trying Indian food for the very first time, which made me a little bit nervous. And they're a foodie, so that was interesting. But they did a great job of making sure, you know, that I had the food that I could try that wasn't too spicy. And just little things like that really made me feel appreciated and safe. So we talked about that. And I'm not sure why I was feeling the way that I was or why they were feeling the way that they were, but I found that being able to talk about it using this model was really helpful.
You know, that's wonderful.
What were we able to do? Well,
yeah,
I was able to, you know, bite the bullet and give Indian food a try. There was always the backup plan of going for Thai food next door if I didn't like it, and we talked about, you know, that. And so I was willing to change how I felt about trying something new and being in the presence of this person that I hadn't spent much time with. So I felt much more comfortable going into this and experiencing this interaction than before I was familiar with this roadmap.
So you felt comfortable enough not just to plan everything out yourself before you went into this situation with this person, but you actually presented the idea of talking about feelings and with the idea of presenting the model and talking about what would be ideal for both of you to feel?
Yeah.
Oh, that's really
exactly.
Cool.
And the waitress even became involved. Because, they shared with the waitress that this is my first time eating Indian food and that I'm a very fussy eater. And so the waitress even came by the table a few times to check up on me and make sure, you know, that everything was all good. And it was a wonderful dinner. And I brought leftovers home and ate some the next day. It was much less scary eating leftovers, of course. But overall, just a nice experience.
So I'm really glad, because I sort of know the relationship we're talking about, and it sounds like that the meeting that you were hoping went really well.
It did go really well, yeah. And I think had I not gone through and learned about this model, not that it would have been a bad interaction, but I feel like it was that much better, because I felt like I had prepared for it, but again, used dialogue to help make everyone feel safe and comfortable.
Sarah, it's a great story, and I'm really glad you called to share it. I appreciate your stepping up and letting people know also about the roadmap, that are other people that may, you know, at some point want to come to the workshop or something. But I'm just delighted that it's working for you.
Thank you so much, Chuck. Have a great day.
Okay, you too, Sarah. Thanks a million. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, so someone from my workshop called. Sarah. Thank you, Sarah. And Danielle called, and I really appreciate it. So those are a couple of the phone calls. I still have got about a half hour left, folks. So if you got something on your mind, you'd like to share it. If you got something that, you know, if you're a regular listener and you've used the emotion roadmap in some meaningful way, I'd love for you to call in and tell me about that as well. The number's 203-336-9756. 203-336 9756. I wanted to talk about something else if we don't get a call in the next few minutes. I'll give you a minute. Again, the number's 203-336-9756. I got another call. Hi, this is Chuck Wolf. You're on the air. Who am I talking to?
Hi, Chuck. This is Anthony from Mount Sinai.
Hi, Anthony. How are you?
Good. Thank you so very much for the programming. And I would hope that all your listeners would contribute to the station, even if it's just $5 or $6. I always feel if you make small monetary contributions, they never hurt, and they're so much easily apply to the services. I mean, if everybody gave $5, I think the station would probably flush, you know?
I think so, Anthony. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for the plug. Hey, which Mount Sinai are you from? I know there's a mental health hospital.
We're in on Long Island, across the Sound from you guys. And, you know, I always listen to PKN. Outstanding programming, great DJs. And I'm sure you yourself are probably volunteering as we speak.
Absolutely.
And I commend you for that. I mean, to take your time out of your day. Everybody's busy. And you DJs or moderators, whatever you want to consider, producers, you do an outstanding job and a service, and you do it from your heart, you know. And I think that's why the programming is always so good at PKN, is because the people that do it are doing it from, you know, the depths of their soul rather than from, you know, like when you watch television, there always seems to be a corporate agenda or what have you within the programming that you get there. Even PBS has been compromised these days, I notice. It's really gone way down. You know, it used to be the flagship of democracy, and now it seems to be the, you know, the stepchild of the powers that be once again. You know, it seems as though we always find ourselves in those positions, you know, in a society as we've grown older, you know.
Well, Anthony, I really appreciate the plug for PKN. I've been a member of the station now for 6 years, and I love this place. It's I mean, you may not agree with everything you hear on the station, but you hear people speak from their heart. You know that people take they want to represent different alternative voices. They also from the music. I've listened to, you know, I'm sure everybody has over the years, a lot of different radio stations. But I you know, one of the things about the music people play on this station is they know the story often behind the music that they play, and you get such education about what you're listening to and such various taste. You go from My Messiah, who was just before me on reggae, and he does a wonderful job with that. And then Richard Epstein comes in with sometimes classical, which sometimes he's playing classical, sometimes he's playing folk, sometimes country. He's lots of different music. And Nick Jacobs has a unique show. Those are the ones just to follow on me. And it's just kind of fun for me to listen to the station whenever I'm around. Anytime I'm driving through the area and I can pick the station up, I'm listening to it.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. You know, I've been listening to the station since the early 80s, and I've been turned on to a great many styles of music, genres, even just you know, conversations with eclectic people or people you not otherwise see, whether it's a Noam Chomsky type of thing or what have you. And it's just a phenomenal, phenomenal resource to the community at large. And unfortunately, I mean, stations like yourselves are—they're going, you know, far and few between. And you know, whether Clear Channel has a play in it or what have you, either way, you guys have stayed true to your mission, I think. And I absolutely love—I mean, there's the Car Bob show sometimes on Saturday mornings where they allow people to call in and they field questions about, you know, repairing of automobiles. I mean, the list goes on and on. They used to have a thing called Radio Free Bridgeport, which also was a phenomenal, you know, moment in time where it allowed various listeners to chime in on the various topics that affect their lives. And, you know, it's oh so important, you know, especially in this day and age. You know, I've always felt that that's where terrorism comes from, is when people aren't allowed to have a seat at the table or a voice. To voice a concern that might press them. And, you know, I think that whether it's a C-SPAN, which is another call-in show, which allows people to vent their issues, these are good things. You know, when people get to chime in on various topics, it makes them less agitated or less resentful, and then less likely to act out in other ways. And you know, whether you realize it or not, just this time, you know, is being spending with you at any given moment, these various callers that you have come in, I think it probably means a lot more to them than they actually realize, you know, as far as venting and speaking to somebody who's neutral and will give them a perspective that they might not otherwise think about, you know, just like the music you play. I mean, I've heard artists that I would have never, ever even thought that I would have liked, but only due to PKN's open mind, Have I been, educated in a way that, I mean, God, it's enriched my life. I mean, you can't say enough about the station.
Well, the goal for this show is because another piece that contributes to people, you know, doing, you know, dastardly things is that, you know, a lack of emotional control or, you know, emotion management. And I don't think there's, you know, there are some steps being taken. And let me use this as a forum to just say a couple things about that. The show that we do the three Wednesdays a month, I'm on the first, second, and fourth Wednesdays at 12, from 12 to 1, is all about helping people deal with emotional challenges. But to teach people about emotion management and about how to influence other people's emotions in a constructive way and how to deal with really confrontational issues in ways that don't seem confrontational. Because, you know, there's lots of times we find there are tough issues to talk about, and we don't have a lot of training for that. But I do want to do a shout out to the Center for Emotional Intelligence at Yale University. I've done some work with them, and Mark Brackett's their director, and he just hosted this past weekend Lady Gaga, because Lady Gaga has partnered with the center to help with her Born This Way Foundation to create what they're calling an emotion revolution. And they're working with high school kids across the country to try and find ways to help high school kids learn how to be emotionally healthy. And I just think it's great. It's a great thing what they're doing. And so I wanted to give a compliment to them and also to the town of Bridgeport. We're housed in Bridgeport, Connecticut. And Bridgeport is one of the school systems that has fully embraced the Yale Center of Emotional Intelligence program called RULER that they're embedding into the school system at Bridgeport. And I'm sure there are good things to come as a result of that. So I wanted to say that I think there are ways that this particular, you know, my show is trying to help people be more aware of the initiatives that are out there besides the show itself, but also anybody that's able or takes the time and wants to call in. If I can help them, hopefully when I'm helping them, I'm helping everybody who's listening.
Absolutely. And, you know, you've made an eloquent point in that, you know, I think as a society or a civilization, you know, whether it's because there's a large people living on top of each other, we have become very much an emotional society with a lot of frustration and a lot of inability to cope with various things that are coming at us on a continuous basis. You know, a good example would have been a day ago, there was a young lady, I guess, who acted out in South Carolina in a classroom, and then the school security officer came in and kind of tussled with her and dragged her out violently. And, you know, as a society, we need to really come to terms with the fact that a lot of young minds are less, they're always rebellious. And I think that Gandhi had it best where, you know, you'd need to just distance yourself from people that act out and not reduce yourself to their level. And what I mean by that, like in that instance with that young lady, she was obviously having an issue and she was acting out. And, you know, what they should have done, everybody should have left the classroom and gone to a different classroom and allowed her to be in the class by herself. And I think that nonviolent approach would have been the better course to take in that instance, especially when you're speaking in an academic arena, you know, because those children are there to learn, and they learn by example. And to call in a, you know, might make right kind of sit thing, you know, it really was not a good lesson for the students, you know, that were being productive and cooperative. As well, the student that acted out, because I'm sure it didn't affect her well. And who knows, you know, as her life carries on, where that will take her, you know, that type of... I think, you know, when I was a young man, my mother never used to hit me. She would just give me the silent treatment, and there was nothing worse than that. You know, if someone you care about, be it friends, family, your peers, your teachers, if they don't talk to you because of your actions, I think that has a greater effect than any form of reprimand, violence, or even spanking, you know? So I think we could learn a lot from that, you know? And it's unfortunate that our society, you know, our leaders, you know, our President Bush, you know, he with his shock and awe. I mean, that was an act of terrorism against a citizenry that was not responsible for the acts of their leader. And ultimately, you know, it brought about, I think, changes in the Middle East that we now have to deal with.
Anthony, I'm going to stop you because, you know, the show's not political, and there's a couple of things that you've just made that are pretty political, couple of statements. And I will say this about it, though. I will say something about when you're dealing with anger, people often come back with force. You know, yep, when you're angry against them and they come back and forth, a better strategy, if it's available to you, because it's not always, but if you can be disappointed with someone instead of angry with someone, you often get better return. So that's
exactly.
That's one of the things I think. I don't know if it's always possible.
Yeah,
in,
I apologize if I went off track, you know, because when you're just rambling kind of here, there's no, but yes, you know, I think that you offer a great service to the listeners. And I just wish I lived in a more peaceful society where people could work things out. And you just made the best point of all, is that, you know, we need to just show disappointment when people do things that we disapprove of, rather than be confrontational and allow things to escalate, because, you know, it just gets worse for everybody involved, you know.
Okay. Well, I really appreciate the phone call, Anthony. Thanks so much for calling in and saying such nice things about PKN.
Absolutely, and please, all the listeners, anybody, just give in $5. If everybody gave $5, you know, the station would be able to, you know, carry on without fundraising and stuff, you know. So thank you so very much for taking your time, and I wish you the best of luck. And I will continue to listen to your program. This is the first time I've heard you, so I'm enjoying it, and I'll do so again. You said next Wednesday?
Yeah, I'm on first, second, and fourth Wednesdays of the month. Please tell other people about it as well, then.
Absolutely. Thank you so very much, and you have a great day.
You too, Anthony. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Okay, so that's kind of a nice show so far, right? We got three phone callers, Danielle, Sarah, Anthony. Very nice comments about it. And by the way, if you do want to donate, you can make that happen by going to WPKN.org. And also, if you happen to be anywhere close to the Bridgeport area, you can be a volunteer at the station. It's great to be part of this community. It's really, as Anthony was telling, there's a lot of nice things happening here with a lot of really great people who devote themselves to their shows, to the station, to the community. We are a community-based station. We depend on you for funds. We serve, in particular, through 89.5 FM. Bridgeport, and we serve Fairfield, New Haven, Litchfield counties in Connecticut, and Suffolk County in New York, and communities around the world at WPKN.org. Again, there's so many nice things. If you pay attention to the announcements at the end of the show, you'll often hear a lot of what's going on about around town, and we're involved with a lot of it. We do a lot of neat things, and it's fun to be part of it. Maybe we'll try and find some ways to do more things on the web, so more of our listeners who can't be close by and attend the movies we help this co-sponsor, or the music events that we co-sponsor, or the car show and the guitar show we just co-sponsor. So if perhaps we can find some ways to do some fun things on the internet too, so people can feel like they're part of that aspect of the community as well. You know, it's interesting. Anthony raised a couple of points about politics, and I try to steer clear of politics. But I did get a question, only because, you know, as soon as you say something about whether you're talking about George Bush or you're talking about President Obama or you're talking about Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump or Bernie Sanders, immediately people take, you know, they put their stake in the ground and take a position, if they're paying attention anyway. And I got a phone call about someone who was, you know, it was a woman who called and it was asking about her, the person she lives with. I don't know if it's a partner or husband or whatever, but wants to talk about politics a lot. And she, you know, she's open to an occasional conversation, but it's like over the top. So I had suggested a strategy for that. And there's a couple of things that's really interesting. One is, one of the things I wanted to just ask you to think about for a moment is, in your mind, do you know any stupid people, right? Do you know anybody that you think is stupid? And then chances are, if you think about somebody, they're not really stupid. They just may have said some things that you think are really dumb. Does that seem like it might be right for you? And if a smart person says something that seems particularly dumb to you, does that make them stupid? And the reason I'm saying that is because part of what's happening in our world right now, I think, is this tremendous polarization. Tremendous. So that, and actually there was some science where they scanned the brain and they were able to watch when certain subjects get introduced to people. There's a brain freeze that happens. People can't process information that's different on certain beliefs that they have. So if you're, let's take, abortion is a topic that often creates brain freeze, right? Because you're on one side or the other of that. And there isn't really a lot of gray area for a lot of people. I mean, I find gray all over the place. I don't see so much black and white often. And I try to understand different positions. And one of the things that struck me years ago when I was in business, and, you know, you're sitting around in a meeting and you're trying to come up with some way to handle a particular challenging situation that you're facing, and nobody really knows the right way. But you're all struggling to come up with what you think are good ideas. And then somebody says something you think is incredibly dumb. And, you know, I used to think, boy, that's stupid. And then I caught myself after a few times of doing it. I thought, you know what? Everyone sitting in the room with me is a smart person. That person said something that didn't make sense to me. But I'm not going to assume they're dumb. I'm going to assume I don't know why they would have said that. And there must be a reason. Now, I may not agree with the reason, but there must be a reason that they said what they did. Can you imagine doing that with someone that you disagree with? Can you imagine someone who says to you, you know, I don't think Hillary Clinton did anything wrong about Benghazi or her email server. And you're thinking, what? Sure. Or I think Donald Trump would be a good candidate. And you're thinking, what? But if they're smart people, and by the way, there's a lot of people apparently who do think Donald Trump would be a good candidate, and a lot of people who are upset with Hillary Clinton, and a tremendous number of people who are supportive of both, you know. So they've got people on both sides, right? And yet, it's always interesting to me to let go of any prejudice I might bring to the conversation and just simply ask, why would you think he's a good candidate? Or why do you think she'd make a good president? And in asking those questions, I allow myself to really listen and not defend against, not want to speak. I think it was the Dalai Lama that said something along the lines of, when we're speaking, we're not learning. We're saying things we already know. When we're listening, at least there's a chance that we might be learning, right? So it was just kind of triggered by what Anthony said, and also a caller the last time I was on who asked about what can I do when somebody's talking too much politics to me. So I don't want to talk about this anymore. I just wanted to say that if you've got somebody who in front of you that you think is smart and they have a different point of view about what they think makes sense, whether it's about politics or anything else, but it sounds strange to you, see if you can open yourself up. Let go of your own prejudice. Just see if you can just try to understand, why is this person who I care about and I'm interested in and I like and I think is usually smart sound so stupid right now to me? And then see if you can get past, you know, the idea of judging somebody until you sort of understand what's behind whatever it is they're saying. I know that people feel appreciated when you listen to them, no matter what they're saying. If you don't judge them, if you don't argue with them. Now, just some food for thought about how to manage emotions as we get closer and closer to election time. I know there's local elections coming up in next week. In a lot of towns. So hopefully you're supportive and you know who you want to vote for and you've been thoughtful and you're picking candidates that are going to do the best for all of us. The other thing I wanted to talk about was, I don't know about you, but it's been a long time since I went to high school, quite a long time. And I had the chance to go back last night and have dinner with people I haven't seen since 1966. It was high school. That was when I was high school. So I saw some people that I hadn't seen in so many years, and it was so nice to catch up with them. But before I went, I have to say I felt a little bit of, gee, what's this going to be like? You know, a little bit uncomfortable about all those years, all that time. Would it be a positive experience? Would people be very different? Would people be judgmental? What would the experience be like? And all I can say, it was just a lot of fun. It was really, really fun to catch up with folks and just hear about everybody's life. And, you know, I was talking to a bunch of people and all of whom seemed to have had very nice lives. So that made it very nice, very pleasant. So it was really nice to kind of get together and spend some time doing that. But sometimes when you go back and you visit with people out of your past, do you ever get kind of queasy about what that might be like? But I ask myself, you know, if I'm feeling a bit anxious and I want to feel confident, what do I need to do, right? Isn't that how the emotion roadmap works? How do you make yourself feel okay about things? You know, if feeling anxious isn't going to be helpful. And it wasn't. I mean, it's just, you know, why would I be anxious? Nothing's going to change because of whatever happened last night. And so just go and see if you can enjoy it. See if it's fun. If it's not fun, don't do it again. If it's fun, see if you can do it again. I think we're going to do it again. My wife and I went. It was really a lot of fun. And then I got back in time to see the Mets game. I was listening to the Mets in the car on the way home. And the Mets and the Royals in the World Series. I don't know if you're baseball fans, but two outstanding baseball teams. And I grew up in Massachusetts where the Red Sox were a religion. And I was part of Red Sox Nation. And I grew up with the Red Sox, adoring them. And they're tough to adore this year, I have to say. But I like baseball, and it was great baseball. I got back home, and I stayed up till 1 o'clock, and I finally went to bed in the 13th inning. And I guess the Mets lost in the 14th. But I don't know, just two great baseball teams, and a lot of fun to watch them if you enjoy baseball. All right, so I got a little bit of time left. I got time for another phone call if you want to call. So I've got 203-336-9756. 203-336-9756. So I'm waiting for your phone call here. So I'm waiting for the next person who's got something they'd like to share that I might be able to help with that other people can talk a bit about. Or also, if you're a regular listener and you've used the emotion roadmap in any meaningful way and you found it works well, then give me a call also. And while you're waiting, if you're just tuning in and you don't know much about the show, I'll walk you through the emotion roadmap. So here's how it works. Something in your life is causing you to be reflective. I think most of you would agree that when things are going smoothly, that you're not spending time thinking about how to deal differently with things or worrying about what to say to this person or that person or how to what's the agenda for the next meeting you have or how to present information. I think when things are working, you're just kind of moving forward. You're not being reflective. So when are you reflective? When something matters and it's a concern and you're unclear about how to proceed, either on your own, because it's something just inside you and you're unclear about. Let me give you an example. Let's say you're doing really well in the company you work for, but the company's not doing well. And you're the sole provider, husband, wife, whoever you are, the other person in your family is staying home and helping out raising children. And you're the person bringing in the majority of the income. And you know you're doing really well where you are, but the company's struggling. And you know that companies sometimes fail. And when they fail, everybody's let go. And that can happen without any warning. What should you be doing? Now, if you feel loyal to your boss, to the company, because they've done really good things for you, you have a really good career with them, you have great opportunities for advancement, everything's working, and yet you know the company may not be there 6 months from now, 1 year from now, 1 month from now. You know there's a risk in staying at the company. What do you do? How are you feeling inside? So in this case, you might be feeling anxious. You might be feeling disloyal if you think at all about leaving. So when you're feeling this way, one of the things that we know about feelings is whatever it is we're feeling causes us to think certain thoughts and behave certain ways. So, for instance, if we're allowing ourselves to feel really disloyal to even consider moving to another company, to even consider that, and this feeling of disloyalty causes us to not reach out, not redo our resumes, not let people who are recruiters know that we're looking, that we don't do any of that because we don't want to feel disloyal. It's too uncomfortable to feel disloyal. And to stop our feeling disloyal, we stay loyal and we stay in the company and we sacrifice any opportunities we might have to move on to some place that might be more stable and more secure. But what if you wanted to argue with yourself about the feeling of disloyalty as to the company? What about the loyalty to your family? What about the responsibility to make sure that you continue to bring in an adequate income to provide for your partner, your spouse, your children? And you don't see that happening at the existing company. What about that feeling? So the roadmap looks at these feelings and it says, okay, so this is how we are feeling. How do we want to feel? And we try to lock in on what would be ideal to feel. In this particular case, for me, I think the ideal feeling is a sense of responsibility, a feeling of accountability. And that results in my not feeling disloyal to my boss and to the company because I know that the company is in trouble. And yet recognizing that there will be a loss at the company if I leave because I'm doing good work and I matter here. But thinking that my responsibility and my loyalty really need to be to my family, more to my company, right? More to my family than to my company. It's really important to consider things like this because sometimes that initial feeling of disloyalty just shuts us down. And so we want to learn how to manage ourselves more effectively. And this whole idea of an emotion roadmap is this idea of thinking about how do we want to manage ourselves? How do we want to do that? How do we create the feelings we want in order to create more ideal situations? How do we create the feelings we want when we've got something tough to tell someone else? As Danielle, and our first caller, shared a little bit about, you know, this idea of feedback. Really want to get some feedback, but really uncertain about how to ask for it, really unclear what to do with it when I get it. And I also think that the other people should be the ones stepping up and doing something different. So we helped her try to resolve that by looking at, hey, if you wait for somebody else to address this and they're not, you may never get the relationship back. If you think there's a strategy that you might use that you can employ to create the feelings you want, and you're willing and able to do that, then you've got a chance to take that relationship back based on you feeling empowered and you doing something. Now, you may not think it's fear, but is fear what's important or is the relationship what's important? Because if you think what's fear is important, then you just let it go and you don't have the relationship. If you think the relationship is what is important, then look for things that you can do, that you can be responsible for yourself, that you can plan and that you can implement. And then you feel empowered. Then all of a sudden it's, I can do something about this. I can make something happen. Well, folks, I'm getting close to the end of my show. And in closing, I want to just say to everybody, I really appreciate all of you who have been listening. I really appreciate Anthony as a new listener. He's going to tell people about the show. I really appreciate Sarah who called in and shared, you know, something that she was able to do with the emotion roadmap, and she's become an advocate for it with her colleagues and friends, which is just great. Thank you so much, Sarah, for calling in and sharing that neat news, not only about the fact that you're telling people about the work that I do and how meaningful the model is, but that you're finding some benefit for yourself. I'm really tickled to hear that, and I'm very thankful that you're able to use it in that way. And also to Danielle, who was the first caller and made it easy for other people to call. And I hope, Danielle, that you do what we talked about, that you find it rewarding and that at least one, maybe both of those two people become friends again, good friends. And if you listen to what Sarah said, you know, if you can go into the situation saying, hey, I'm not feeling great about what's happening between us, and I don't think you are either. And I'd like to talk about what might be ideal to feel, and I was talking to somebody and kind of suggested that maybe this is the way I go about it. Maybe you can get to those ideal feelings like Sarah was able to in the relationship she was talking about. So everybody, I want to thank you all for listening to my show. New listeners, old listeners, regular listeners, thank you so much. I appreciate it. I'll be back next week with you. This is Chuck Wolf. You've been listening to the Emotion Roadmap. Take the wheel and control how you feel. WPKN 89.5 FM in Bridgeport. Serving Fairfield, New Haven, Litchfield counties in Connecticut and Suffolk County in New York, and communities around the world at WPKN.org.
Funding for Simsbury Community Television is provided in part by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.